great pleasure to be here in Poland for many reasons. I've only been here for 2 days, but it's been so interesting for me on many levels. It's been very interesting for me as an American. I've been reading about Polish history and just appreciating the many ways that our countries each helped each other to gain independence and have supported each other, have had many common enemies, and have never been opposed in any way. It's also been extremely interesting for me personally, because when people would ask me what my ancestry is, what's my ethnic group, I always said, I'm Russian Jewish. All four of my ancestors came from, well, three came from Russia and Belarus. One was born, my father's father was born in Kielce in Poland, but you know, three of them were from Russia and Belarus, so I said, I'm Russian Jewish. Well, I went to the Poland Museum yesterday. I learned all about the very long history of Jews in Poland, and I discovered that Russia has nothing to do with it other than brutally moving my ancestors hundreds of miles east at some point. So from now on, whenever anyone asks me, now I know the real answer. I am Polish Jewish. All of my ancestors are from Poland. The borders were drawn differently at different times, but my ancestry is Polish. It has also been fascinating for me professionally, studying morality and politics, because my God, are your politics complicated? It's not a normal left-right spectrum because of your amazing history, especially this gigantic, monstrous pillar of communism right in the middle of your history, which is seems to be warping or changing your current politics. So it's been very interesting to look at that. Originally, I was going to talk about capitalism today. That's my next book, is Moral Psychology and Capitalism, Business, Economics. But in my conversations with journalists and with students, it's become clear that a central concern in Poland today is the fact that you feel as though you're coming apart politically, as though you're not united as a country, as though you don't really understand what's happening and you're frustrated. And boy, does that sound familiar to me as an American. That's very much our situation. So I thought what I would do is I'm often asked to speak in the United States on political polarization because it's a huge problem. It has completely paralyzed us. We are unable to make public policy anymore to a large extent. And so we're trying to figure out what's going on. And so I thought what I would do is tell you the general story, the psychology of this. How does this happen in the United States, and then applying it to Poland, where I have data or where I can see the clear connections. And then we'll have plenty of time for conversation afterwards to talk through what lessons moral psychology might have for Poland today. The book is not just about politics. Actually, understanding morality should help you in all of your relationships. But I think a common interest today, especially this day after Election Day, is in politics. So I thought I'd focus on that. So I'll cover four topics. What is happening, why it is happening in terms of history and politics, why it is happening in terms of moral psychology, and then finally, what can be done. So in the United States, we have this increasingly large divide between, that's the symbol of the Democrats and the Republicans. To show some data on it, this is the degree of polarization in the two houses of our Congress, the House of Representatives and the Senate. Going back to the 1940s, the level of polarization on the left-right dimension was very, very low. But it's been going up and up and up in the 50s, 60s, 70s, and especially in the 90s, it's reached historically high levels. Now, if we bring the graph all the way back to 1880, in the years after America had a horrible civil war, America was very polarized in the wake of this gigantic war that killed 500,000 people in a much smaller country. And then some things changed, and we got very low polarization. And then they changed again, and now we're back. And so this is terrible, but it is not historically unprecedented. So we need to understand, how does this happen, and how does it change? You can see what's happening to us here. Let me explain what this is. This is a Pew. There's a company called Pew, which surveys Americans frequently. And if you look at how far apart Americans are by gender, if you just look at men versus women on a set of issues, abortion or gun control or prayer in schools, and you take the absolute value of the difference, what you see is that men and women were about 4 points apart back in 1987. Not much. Men and women have very similar political attitudes. And over time, from 1987 through 2012, 4% to 6%. So it's been pretty steady, no change. By religion, still not very divided. Rich versus poor, a little more divided, but it's been constant over time. Education, even by race, we're very divided by race. Yet even still, black and white in America are about 12 points apart. So that's moderate, but it's been steady over time. We're not getting more polarized by any of those factors. But if you split us by political party, that's this yellow line. We were 10 points apart in the 1980s, and then in the late 90s, it starts going up and up and up, and here's what's happened since 2002. So America is now extremely divided if you compare Democrat to Republican. This is very new. It's only about 12 to 15 years old. Related to this polarization is a very big drop in our confidence in government, our trust in government. So this is confidence in our Supreme Court, in the dark green line, in our Congress, and in the president. And what you see was very high in 1991, right after we fought our first war with Iraq. But in the 1990s, it's moderate. It's not good, but it's not terrible. And it's actually going up a little bit in the 1990s during the presidency of Bill Clinton. But then, especially after George W. Bush, not that it was his fault per se, but around 1998 to 2002, things really started going down everywhere. 7% of Americans have some level of trust in the U.S. Congress. In other words, nobody, just about. I think 7% is just the Congress people and their families, actually. So this is a terrible situation. It's very hard to have a democracy when nobody trusts the government. So is this happening in Poland, too? So I went online last night because there are now many international surveys that are done about trust in government across many countries. And here's what I found. In one recent survey, this is called the Edelman Trust Barometer. In 2013, they looked at about 35 countries or so. So actually, surprisingly, in China, well, Singapore is not a surprise. That Singapore has a very high trust in government. But actually, China, India, so these are some countries that have very high, they express very high levels of trust in their government. The US is sort of in the middle. Poland is not doing very well. It's, I'm not sure if it's 48%. I think it's 48%. Across several different kinds of trust that Polish people have. So you're in the lower third, but that was in 2013. Then they did it again in 2014, and now Poland is at the very, very bottom. So what I'm detecting in my conversations is that Polish people think things are getting worse. Trust is declining, political animosity is increasing. And so the data at least bears that out. And this is a big problem for a democracy. It's a big problem for the kind of compromise that is necessary to make good policy. Just more specifically from that study, what they found is if you break it down, this is now trust in government specifically. Poland was at 30% of Poles said they had some degree, a moderate or high degree of trust in government back in 2013. You're now down to 19%, which is the lowest it's ever been, or at least since communism, I imagine. So very, very few Poles express any trust in the government. Trust in business is a little bit higher. It's higher in almost every nation. Almost every nation, they trust business more than they trust government. In Poland, it was 56% expressing some trust. Then last year, it was down to 49%. So this is a problem. This is a big problem for your country, as it is for my country. So that's an overview of what's happening. Okay, now, why? Why does this sort of thing happen? So most of the story must be told by historians and political scientists, not by psychologists. So first I'll tell you a few of the overarching facts, and then we'll zoom in on the role that psychology plays. So in America, the story is very complicated. There are 10 different factors, at least, that explain why it's happening now. I'm not going to go through them all. I just want you to get a sense of the kinds of sociological and historical factors that matter. So in the United States, we had a period of party realignment. Our two parties used to have a lot of overlap on the left-right spectrum, but they've become very much separated now that it's liberal versus conservative. And as that happens, people with one temperament or another move into those parties so that now the people in the two parties dress differently, eat differently, read different books. They're very different people, and that makes it easier for them to dislike each other. So we've got this mass sorting going on. I'll just show you one of the most important effects of that when you really get a separation of different kinds of people is that they can dislike each other much, much more. So these are ratings that go back to 1976, President Jimmy Carter's time. On a 0 to 100 scale, how much do you like the Supreme Court or Italian people or African Americans? These are the sorts of survey questions that get asked every 2 years in America. And what you find is when you ask about, if you ask Democrats how much they like the Democratic Party, you find they like it, about 75, and that's been true for the last 30 years. They give very high ratings to their own party. Here's Republicans rating the Republican Party, very high, not a surprise. But what about the other party? How much do Democrats like the Republican Party? 50 is neutral, no feelings. So it used to be they slightly dislike them, but not too bad. And it goes down a little bit, but even under President Bill Clinton, Democrats slightly dislike the Republicans, and Republicans, the red line, slightly dislike the Democrats, on average. That's not bad. But what's happened since then? It's plunged. Now they really dislike each other. And this means we have gone from being opponents across the parties to being enemies. And that is very dangerous. So that's the result of those. One other factor, and I think this might be relevant in Poland, this increasing dislike. Another factor that might be relevant in Poland is the changing of the generations, because there is some interesting research showing that events that happen to you between around age 16 and 24, that period, get burned into you for life. That's a very open period politically, and people are very passionate at those young ages, and the big historical events that happen shape you for life. So what happened in America, we had a whole generation that was shaped by World War II, as the whole planet did. And when they came to political power, they were very good at coming together and working together. We call them the greatest generation. So people who remember World War II, so this is Ronald Reagan and then the leading Democrat of the time, Tip O'Neill, who ran the Congress, the Democratic Congress. They were both Irish, they both loved to drink, they would fight and argue during the day, and in the afternoon they would get together, they'd have a drink, they'd talk. They could work together. We get our first baby boomer president, Bill Clinton, born after World War II. Now, and this is Newt Gingrich, the head of the Republicans. They didn't like each other personally. And they didn't work together terribly well, but there were enough older people in Washington, the institutions still worked. Republicans and Democrats still talked to each other. So they were able to forge a working relationship. Even though they didn't like each other, they could work together, and they did on some big issues. But now that the greatest generation is gone, nobody alive in America, nobody active in politics remembers World War II. Those people are all in their 80s now. Now we get Barack Obama and John Boehner, the leader of the Republicans. They really dislike each other and they cannot work together. So now we're in big trouble. Our parties simply cannot work together. An example of this is this interesting episode that happened. This is John Wayne, very conservative, very much a Republican. In 1961, after John F. Kennedy was elected president, he was asked what he thought about the election of this Democrat, John Kennedy. And he said, "I may not have voted for him, but he's my president, and I hope he does a good job." A few years ago, after Barack Obama was elected president, this man is Rush Limbaugh. He's one of the leading right-wing talk show figures. He has a radio show, and he gets conservatives very angry. So his name is Rush Limbaugh. He was asked, after Obama was elected, if he would contribute 100 words, 100-word essay or little statement about his hopes for the Obama presidency. And they asked a lot of people on the right and the left to contribute these ideas. And he refused. He said, "No, I won't do it." And then on his radio show, he talked about this. And he said, "I don't need 100 words. I need only 4. I hope he fails." Now, this is a time when America is facing catastrophe, economic catastrophe, from the meltdown of our financial institutions. And he says, "I hope he fails." This is hyperpartisanship. Partisanship is okay. Partisanship is part of democracy. Of course you want different political parties arguing. That's good. That's normal. But when it becomes, when it gets to very high levels, and especially when group identity gets stuck at one level, that's where it becomes toxic. There's a wonderful Arab proverb, not proverb, but a little saying. It says, "Me against my brother. Me and my brother against our cousin. Me, my brother, and cousin against the stranger." So that's normal human tribalism. We're very good at working together to fight someone else, and then when that comes apart, then we can fight each other. We're very good at that. Hyperpartisanship is when the partisan identity is everything. So no matter what threats your country faces, all you care about is hurting the other side. Obviously, this is a disaster for your country, but this is where we are in the United States. So I'm curious as to whether you think today's leaders are hyper-partisan or just normal partisan. Actually, let's take a vote. So the question is, raise your hand if you think your leaders are hyper-partisan, as I've described. Please raise your hand. Okay, and raise your hand if you think, no, it's just normal partisanship. They can work together when they need to. Raise your hand. Nobody. Okay. So this is very bad for democracy. You can't get good policy when they can't work together. So that's all I'll say about that one. There's so many other things that happen. Obviously, one that's relevant for you is the end of the Cold War, the loss of a common enemy. So of course, when Solidarity was fighting the communists, all Poles could unite behind Solidarity and the church. One interesting one, increasing immigration and racial diversity. That's rising in America and almost all of Europe. That makes it harder to agree. You don't have that in Poland, which is so interesting and unusual. So that should be one thing that works to your advantage. But you find other things to fight about, of course. Okay, so that's all I'll say about the history. Most of what I want to tell you is about moral psychology, and that's the subject of my book, The Righteous Mind. So let's look into how the moral psychology interacts with all those historical and sociological features that I told you about, and let's try to apply it to Poland. So this is the cover, the original hardcover of the book. It shows a kind of rip, a tear. In the UK, they had a very different art department, and so they came up with this cover, which I quite like. In the US, for the paperback, I suggested something about angels and demons, and they found some beautiful images, which really get at the demonization that we'll talk about in a moment. And then here in Poland, they came up with this really evocative and clear and very descriptive, very nice design. So again, it conveys intuitively what the book is about. So there are three principles of moral psychology, and if you understand these three principles, you can apply them to almost any puzzling social situation. Anytime people are divided by morality or religion or politics, if you apply these three principles, I think you'll see some things that you might not have seen before. So the first principle is about intuition comes first, strategic reasoning second, and we'll get to the other two principles in a moment. So there's a long idea in philosophy, actually in every culture, that the mind is divided into parts. My first book was called The Happiness Hypothesis. It was about 10 ancient ideas found East and West, and this, whether or not they're true. And so the first idea, the most important idea in psychology, is that the mind is divided into parts that sometimes conflict. But what's the nature of, what's the relationship between those parts? In the Western tradition, Plato gave us the metaphor that the mind is divided like a charioteer trying to control two unruly horses. So reason is the charioteer, and the horses are the passions. And the charioteer's obligation or duty is to control the passions, and then a man can live reasonably. And most philosophers tend to be very rational, logical people. They mostly think this way. But most people aren't like that. In fact, very few people can work this way. There's a counter tradition in philosophy from David Hume, which I think is correct. Hume was a superb psychologist. Plato was not. Hume said, reason is and ought only to be the slave of the passions and can never pretend to any other office than to serve and obey them. And you can see an example of this general process here. This is my daughter, Francesca, and a few months ago, I made her a smoothie, you know, fruit and ice and ices, and it's, you know, delicious in the blender. And so I gave her some, and then I realized I was kind of thirsty and I wanted to try it. And so I said, Francesca, can I have a sip? And she said, no. She said, you might get my germs. Now, we share food all the time. If I'm eating something sweet, she'll come over and try to eat it from my mouth practically. We share germs all the time. But this little four-year-old's brain was able to automatically say, I want my smoothie. I don't want to share it with Dad. Dad's asking me to share it. Quick, come up with a reason. Germs, okay? Post hoc reasoning. It's there by age 4. At age 2 and 3, she didn't do this. It really only came in around age 4 as they get more theory of mind, as they get more understanding of how other minds work. Now to switch to the psychological research, The simple formulation from Tom Gilovich is, when we want to believe something, we ask, can I believe it? We're looking for permission to believe something. We don't weigh the evidence. We say, I want to believe X. Can I find a reason why X might be true? I look for it. If I find it, I stop thinking. I'm done. I have permission. But if you don't want to believe something, you ask, must I believe it? Am I forced to believe it? Or can I find a single reason to doubt proposition X? And if I can find a reason, I stop thinking. I'm done. So let's see how this works in an experiment. In one study, subjects come into the lab. They're psychology students. Raise your hand if you're studying psychology. How many here are in psychology? Okay, a lot of you. So I don't know if you do the same thing here in Poland, but when you take a psychology course, you have to do some experiments along with it. So the students come into the lab, and they're given what looks like a scientific paper published in a scientific journal that shows a relationship between caffeine consumption and breast cancer. And they're told to read this article and comment on the methods. You're learning how to do scientific experiments. Is this a valid study? Who do you think finds lots of flaws with that study? Who finds problems with it? People who drink coffee. Everybody who drinks coffee? Both sexes? You got it. Women who drink coffee find so many flaws in the study. The sample size isn't big enough, the measurements weren't good, because they're asking, must I believe it? And they're desperately trying to find some reason to doubt it, and they always do. It's very easy to doubt just about anything. So women who drink coffee find lots of flaws in the study. Everybody else says, oh, okay, whatever. Here's another example. In one study, subjects are, they come in, they see a screen in front of them, and lots of images flash up on the screen. And they're told, you'll get 5 cents every time you correctly note a letter. So if you see a letter on the screen, press a button, we'll add up your correct guesses, you get 5 cents for each one, let's say. And so, what's that? What did I just put up? So a B. But let's try it again. I'm going to give you a nickel every time you correctly spot a number. What's that? Okay. So people are not crazy. Nobody says that's 9 or Q. But as long as there's ambiguity, we see what we want to see. In every moral, political debate, there's ambiguity. In every matter of social policy, there's ambiguity. So if half the people are asking, can I believe it? Can I believe this policy is good? They all say, yes, I can believe it. The other half is asking, must I believe it? Must I believe this policy is good? No, they don't have to believe it. And this is why it's almost impossible to convince people with scientific evidence. If they care about it, if it activates their partisan identity, you can't convince them with scientific evidence. Or very rare, it's very hard to do. So that's all I'll say about that first principle. Intuitions come first, strategic reasoning second. Now let's move on to this one. There's more to morality than harm and fairness. So when I was in graduate school, I was really impressed by two things. I was reading anthropology, and boy, was it clear that morality varies around the world. You can't deny that. And I was reading evolution, and boy, was it clear that we're products of evolution, and there's a human nature. Now, how do you reconcile that? And the theory that I came up with, drawing especially on Richard Schwader and other people, was this, that there are at least 6 moral foundations. There are 6. They're really, think of them as like taste buds of the moral sense. These are things that you see, these are issues that you see all over the world. So care, fairness, liberty, loyalty, authority, and sanctity. You find these issues all over the world. When you read anthropologists' reports of small societies in the South Pacific, or any other society, you find evidence of all of these concerns. So that's what evolution gave us. But societies build a culture, they build a moral matrix on top of those foundations, using them to different degrees and constructing them out of local materials as well. So here's how it works. So the first foundation is care versus harm. We're mammals. What does it mean to be a mammal? It means you bear your young live. So the female brain in all mammal species, female brains are specialized for nurturance and care. In most mammal species, the male brain is not. But humans long ago developed a cooperative breeding strategy. Males do contribute, not as much as women, and men are not as compassionate as women. But the male brain is also changed and specialized for care. And men fall in love with their children. Men can be very good parents. This foundation is very, very widely used on the left, at least in the United States and in other countries we've looked at. The left tends to be focused on victims, on suffering, on care and compassion. These are photos I took at Occupy Wall Street, a very left-wing demonstration all around the world, but it started in New York just after I moved to New York 3 years ago. So compassion is our new currency. It's very anti-capitalist. They hate money. The extremists of them. They hate money, they hate capitalism, they hate industry. So they say, get rid of money, let's have compassion. We can buy food with compassion, let's say. Free empathy. I can't hurt another without hurting myself. So these are the sorts of sentiments that you find in left-wing politics. You never see signs like this at a Tea Party rally or other right-wing political movement. They just don't talk about compassion. The second foundation is fairness. You will never find a human society that doesn't care a lot about fairness. Everybody does. But it can mean different things. The key meaning, I believe, is proportionality or equity or karma, the law of karma. That is, you should reap what you sow. People should not take more than they deserve. So on the left, fairness often means equality, not equity, but equality mixed with compassion. So the 1% own 43%. If you're on the left, that inequality is automatically wrong. But if you're on the right, inequality might be actually quite justified. What if the 1% actually create more value? They make better inventions. Of course they should get rich. Marching for the meek and weary, hungry and homeless. Tax the wealthy, fair and square. Everyone's in favor of fairness, but on the left, fairness means there should not be such inequality. On the right, however, these are signs from a Tea Party rally, the right-wing populist movement. Spread my work ethic, not my wealth. Don't take my money to give to lazy people. Stop punishing success, stop rewarding failure. We have a graduated income tax. Rich people pay a higher percentage. They think that's unfair. Stop rewarding failure. Stop giving money to people who failed. You're rewarding failure or laziness. That's the view on the far right. This is in the UK, it's the same idea. Let's cut benefits for those who refuse work. You don't need to recognize that man to know that he's not Labour Party, he's conservative. That's David Cameron. The third foundation is liberty. All Americans believe in liberty, that's our founding creed. We all think that we own liberty and the other side does not. This is the flag of my former state, Virginia. I lived there for 16 years. And it wasn't. There's a very funny thing about the Virginia flag. It has a murder on it. Now, why would you put a murder on your flag? It's a very strange thing to do. But what if I tell you that the flag was created in 1778, 2 years after the American colonies revolted against their king? The early Americans were English. They were not American. They were English people living in the New World, and they decided they wanted to rebel against their king. And so they had to justify it. And what they did was they justified it with the murder of Julius Caesar, sic semper tyrannis, thus always to tyrants. So this is a very deep psychological principle. When we perceive that we're being oppressed, we don't just want to kill the oppressor. We have an urge to actually unite with other people and then kill him. So this is an image from Occupy Wall Street. It shows a fist with 99%, and that little thing says 1%. The image is, If 99% of us could get together, we could crush and kill the rich. Now, there wasn't really any violence associated with Occupy Wall Street, but the iconography was violent. It was about killing the rich, eating the rich. So on the left, you have the psychology of liberty and oppression, but it's corporations and the rich are the oppressors. On the right, in America right now, it's the government that's the oppressor. Don't tread on me. Big government equals less freedom. So government is the bully. That's who we want to rebel against. So both sides value liberty, but they mean very different things by it. Now the next three foundations are special foundations that bind groups together. These are the three on which you really don't find much on the left. So group loyalty. Some animals can work together, but they're always siblings, like wolves or bees and ants, things like that. Only humans can work together in very large groups that are not siblings. We're very good at warfare. We evolved for warfare. We evolved for intergroup violent competition. We've been doing that for probably hundreds of thousands of years. We love it so much that we invent team sports. It makes no sense to spend a lot of time and money watching groups of people kick a ball around. That's just a stupid waste of time. Unless, in your mind, you love war, and you love seeing groups competing against groups. And in America, as in Europe, we love fake war so much we invented super fandom. We get dressed up, we do stupid things in the cold weather to show how much we love our soldiers, our team, our sports team. This ethos, these ideas, play a big role in right-wing morality, not as much in left-wing morality. So, for example, at the Tea Party, a right-wing rally, lots of American flags, lots of patriotism, and conservatives say that liberals are guilty of treason. This is a right-wing person. Treason, liberal treachery from the Cold War to the War on Terror. So they're always accusing liberals, the left, of hating America, of betraying the country. Well, guess what? You can find a lot of evidence of that. Not that most liberals dislike America, but many do. On the far left, many do. So this is an anarchist rally. No, it's the far left. No gods, no country, no masters, so they're anarchists. But look at this. Fuck the troops. Fuck the soldiers. Stop respecting them. Soldiers are bad. Military's bad. Country is bad. America is an oppressor. This is the iconography on the far left, not most of the left. Just, if that's too strong for you, think about the John Lennon song. I assume you all know the song Imagine. I assume it's a famous song here, too. Look at the words of it. Imagine there's no countries. It isn't hard to do. Nothing to kill or die for, and no religion, too. Imagine all the people living life in peace. So the left is universalist. The left is bothered by groups. Even patriotism is often a bad thing on the left. The fifth foundation is authority versus subversion. We're primates. Primates do hierarchy. Primates do rank. It's part of being a primate. We're very good at it, showing deference and respect. We bow, we get small, very similar around the world to the way chimpanzees do it. But on the left, as you saw, there's quite a lot of no masters. There's a lot of resentment or anger against authority. But on the right, you get things like, here's a church in Charlottesville where I used to live. God's in charge, so shut up. Stop complaining. Listen to what God says. Follow the Bible. The last foundation is sanctity and degradation. This is the idea you find it certainly in Catholicism, in Judaism, in Islam, in Hinduism. The idea that you should ever wash before praying, the idea that water is part of religious ritual, it doesn't make logical sense, but many people around the world have the feeling that you should prepare your body before you approach God. The body is really a temple and should be treated as a temple, sometimes at least. And so this is a medieval image, the allegory of chastity. The Virgin Mary is locked up in basically a rock chastity belt, and there are lions guarding the pure stream of her virginity flowing here from out there. So it's a lot of iconography about purity and chastity. So on the religious right and in the Catholic tradition, there's a lot of talk about chastity and purity. On the left is a very different idea because feminism is such a big part of being on the left. So this is an image from Madonna's album Sex from the 1980s, where she very explicitly rejects. Now, of course, she plays up her Catholic identity. Madonna is her name. So that's one Madonna. That's another Madonna. She plays up her Catholic identity, but she specifically rejects this whole ethos, this whole morality. This is an image from a car in my old town, Charlottesville, Virginia. Your body may be a temple, but mine's an amusement park. What's wrong with having fun with your body? Why are you so uptight, you stupid conservatives? And here's a photo I took at Occupy Wall Street. Nothing is sacred. I don't know what it meant, but you could never see such a sign at any conservative rally. It could not happen. But on the left, it's just part of the ideology. So to sum up, here's where we are. I run a research site at yourmorals.org, and we've had about 400,000 people take some of our surveys. I drew from a couple of surveys for this, so 3,700 people in most of these items here. If you go there, you can take the Moral Foundations questionnaire and some other questionnaires. And what we find is that when people come to the site and they register as being very liberal, those people give very high ratings to all of our questions about care and compassion, that it's you should never hurt animals, emotional harm. There's all sorts of questions about care and compassion. They score very high on the left. Now, on the right, this is still above the midpoint, but just barely. So, I mean, they value it, but not as much. This is proportionality. If I'd done equality would slope down like that, but proportionality questions slope slightly up. Liberty questions on economic liberty slope slightly up. But the point is that on the left, they value all three of those, care, fairness, and liberty, but especially care. On the right, however, while they do value those, they also value our questions about authority, loyalty, and sanctity. The left rejects those. They say, no, I don't endorse those. This is not part of morality. But on the right, they actually give pretty similar answers to all of those. So this is data. This is about 80% United States data, and then the rest is scattered around the world. But there are two, let's see, are Lily and Tomek, are you guys here? Are they here today? Lily Kostrzeznowska and Tomek, you can read it yourself. They are psychology students here, and they actually translated the Moral Foundation's questionnaire into Polish, and just last night, they sent me this beautiful data. So this is data just from Poland. And the colors are different, but you'll see it's the exact same pattern, the converging pattern. You get care and, well, they don't have liberty on the next slide, but care and fairness, you'll see. So care and fairness are there, highest on the left, sloping down, but still high. So just like, well, okay, they're slightly different questions, but the point is that you get care and fairness, you get care and fairness there, and you get all of them there. So this is loyalty, authority, and sanctity sloping up, but notice this. Which one is steepest? Which line is steepest? It's this silvery line here. It's hard to read. Sanctity. The Sanctity Foundation is actually, in Poland, the biggest differentiator of left and right. And that fits with the fact that what everybody tells me, it's all about the culture war now in Poland. A lot of it is about the church, church issues, gender, gay rights. So it's a lot of these issues that only make sense if you understand that some people in your country care a lot about sanctity, and they apply that to the body. Other people don't care so much about it. You see it right there. There is the most important fact about the Polish culture war. So I have been learning a little bit about Polish politics. I found some reference to this party. I don't even know how to say it. This is a translation from Google, so it's not a very good translation. But even without a good translation from their website, the National Radical Camp is a social movement that brings together young Poles who are close to the values of God, honor, country, family, tradition. Exactly the same as the American culture war. This is very much our religious conservatives. It's the same idea across countries. God and country, groups, family, respect, tradition, sacredness. Patriotic demonstrations. This party is very, very patriotic. I think knowing these foundations, these six foundations, can really help you understand why Poles disagree with each other over specific issues. Well, we're fine on time. So the last principle is that morality binds and blinds. Here's how it goes. Large-scale cooperation is very, very rare in the animal kingdom. The best examples of it are the bees and the termites. That's a gigantic termite mound about 8 meters tall. So little tiny creatures can work together only if they're siblings. They're all sisters or sisters and brothers. The only counterexample to this, the only species that can build large creations is humans. And so this is Babylon, a reconstruction of ancient Babylon. This is Tenochtitlan in Mexico. And wherever you find ancient civilizations, you always find temples, always. This was part of the human transition from hunter-gatherers to civilization is through religion and temples. This is part of our evolved nature. We have this ability to make something sacred, a god, a sacred tree, a sacred river, a sacred ancestor, a book, make it sacred, and then we circle around it, and that unites us. So these are Muslims at prayer in Mecca. It couldn't be any clearer, the symbolism and the psychology. If you circle around a sacred object, it unites you and it changes you. A metaphor that I like to use is, if you remember from high school physics, if you move a wire through a magnetic field, it generates electricity. And the sociologist Emil Durkheim talked about social electricity generated by rituals. So these rituals generate electricity, the capacity to do work, social work. It doesn't have to be a religion. We make our flags sacred. So in wartime, the flag, we circle around the flag, and that unites us, and then we can go off and fight as a unit. But when you make something sacred, and you generate this electricity, you create a polarity. Our side becomes perfectly good. All the positivity is on our side. And the other side becomes perfectly evil. Everything about them is bad. There's a word for this in the history of religion. It's called Manichaeism. This was a doctrine that comes out of Persia or the Persian area about how the universe is a battle between the forces of darkness and the forces of light. Human beings are on the battlefield, and we all must decide. Are you on the side of good, or are you on the side of evil? Everybody must choose. That way of thinking is called Manichaean thinking. It's very normal. It's part of our politics. It's what happens when you hate the other side. So you get demonization. So just a few images from the United States. You find these on the internet. Take whatever political leader you don't like, search for it on the internet, and you'll find an image of that person as a devil. And in fact, that's Ann Coulter, the woman that I showed you before who's a conservative. So what is happening? I hope you see now that all these historical processes that promote divisions activate a psychology of tribalism that is very good at demonizing. And this is what has happened in the United States, and this is what seems to be happening in Poland. I think you might be a little bit behind us, but you seem to be following us down that cliff. So what can be done? The most important thing for change is really systemic changes. That's how you get big effects, is changing the system. So here are some specific suggestions. It's really important for any country to make reforms that will increase trust in government. It's very hard to do, and you can't have any party do it, because political parties will always make changes that cement their power, that lock in their advantages. The only way to do it is to have politicians agree that that the country is in trouble, that the game is corrupt, that the people hate us in government, so we all should cooperate to improve the game. The best way to do that is to appoint a panel of experts, a panel that includes some political scientists, some people from both sides, let them make a set of recommendations, and then the legislature can pass them all as a package, yes or no. So that's one suggestion. And just, this might not be the issue, but for example, one thing that I think would be very wise for any country to do is give a big raise to all of the politicians and then arrest them if they take a penny. Don't let them receive any money or gifts or anything else, because it's a vital public obligation that they be not just free from corruption, but perceived to be free from corruption. You must increase the rule of law and respect for the judicial system. So obviously these are especially problems in the post-communist countries, because for decades and decades, as I've heard several of you say, everything was lies. Everything from the journalists was a lie. Everything from the government was a lie. So you have a tradition, you have reason, you have a historical memory of being distrustful. And of course, also communism bred a culture of law breaking, because nobody respected the laws. So it's very hard to do. So whatever it takes, whatever you can do to increase respect for the law and respect for the judicial system, so often there are judicial reforms that could be made as well as part of that package. So those are two things that are very, very important. A third is for politicians to model the behavior of being opponents, not enemies. I don't know anything about your leaders in Poland. I don't know if this is possible. Do they hate each other, or do you think they could ever appear together and say, "While we disagree, I at least acknowledge that he loves Poland and has its best interests at heart"? Do you think they could they do that, or is that ridiculous to even imagine? No, you don't think so? Okay, well, maybe when you guys grow up and become become the leaders of the country, maybe you'll be able to do it. But anything you can do that models that kind of respectful disagreement is good for democracy. And lastly, another suggestion is if you can get people to realize that this is a national emergency, you might be able to get some reforms of education so that this is taught openly in the schools. The academic establishment tends to be on the left, so it might be hard. And all parents are upset about teachers indoctrinating their children. But if you can educate for democracy, part of that should be teaching respect for the long traditions of left and right in not just Poland, but all over the West. There's a long philosophical tradition. There are really good ideas on both sides, philosophical ideas. So there are things that you can do to change the system, but they're hard. Before you wait for that to happen, because those systemic changes could take a long time, there are some things that you can do as individuals, that everyone can do as an individual. I don't know if you know this quote from, it's certainly famous in the English language, "The fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves." We all tend to blame others. We tend to find reasons why it's not our fault. But often it is partly or largely our own individual fault. Another way to say this is, of course, one of the most famous lines from the New Testament, from the Sermon on the Mount. "How can you say to your brother, 'Let me take the speck out of your eye,' when all the time there is a plank in your own eye. This is one of the great truths. This is one of the chapters in my book, The Happiness Hypothesis. Every culture has recognized this. Proverbs from Nigeria and Japan say almost the same thing. This is part of human nature. We are so good at finding what's wrong with everyone else, and we are so blind about our own faults. So, here's a really beautiful way that it's been put. Buddhists in particular have been particularly wise about this. This is from an 8th century Zen master in China. If you want the truth to stand clear before you, never be for or against. The struggle between for and against is the mind's worst disease. That's another way of saying morality binds and blinds. As soon as you buy into an ideology and a team, you give up your ability to think for yourself. You give up your ability to be critical about yourself and your side. You buy into Manichaean thinking that misunderstands the motives and the words of the other side. So my hope is that if you learn some moral psychology, you'll be able to see this more in yourself, and we can all at least pledge to do a few things. The most basic is to simply commit to civility. That doesn't mean agreeing with everyone. That doesn't even necessarily mean being nice and friendly and polite. The key meaning is the ability to disagree with others while respecting their sincerity and decency. So just don't demonize, and you'll catch your friends. When you hear your friends saying those stupid conservatives or those, you know, those immoral liberals, whatever it is, when you hear your friends doing it, gently stop them. Say, you know, it might be kind of embarrassing to do this, but you know, you're basically saying this is polluting our democracy. Okay, maybe you can't put it in quite those terms, but that's really what it is. It's okay, it's good to disagree, that's fine. It's the demonization. That's what is dangerous for a democracy. Spread the idea that this is a national emergency. Things are getting worse in Poland, just as they are in America. And you all love your country. You want your country to work well. You want your children to grow up in a better country. Take action. Everybody who cares about Poland should work together on reforms. Again, it's easier said than done. But this is a long-term project. This is a way of thinking that over the years might help you to improve your democracy. And the best way to do this, the best way to actually understand the other side is through relationships. It's very, very difficult to simply encounter arguments and say, oh, what a logical argument. But if you have friends or family in a different political party or on the other side, you have some affection for them, perhaps. That at least makes it possible for you to listen to them. Because as I've said, intuition comes first, strategic reasoning second. So if you can cultivate positive intuitions, positive feelings, if you can approach someone, somebody in your family, let's say, who is on the other side politically, and start by acknowledging something that they are right about, saying something good about their policies or their party or whatever it is, that disarms them. That suddenly makes them see, oh, you're not doing the usual thing where you attack me and I attack you. That validates that you think they're not crazy. You think maybe they're even right about some things. And then that triggers an urge to reciprocate. And they will now be more open-minded to you. Not all the time, but often this will happen. And when it does, it's really thrilling. It's actually really fun to have conversations with people on the other side if you're trying to understand each other. So I urge you to try that as an experiment. So I'll end the way I end the book with this wonderful cartoon. There's a boy talking to his father. The father says, your mother and I are separating because I want what's best for the country and your mother doesn't. So, thank you. So, okay, questions? I think we have two microphones, whether two or one. At any rate, questions or comments?
So thank you very much especially for bringing John Lennon back a little bit, right? Actually, I think you could add, all you need is love, right? There's really a continuation of this to a certain extent. I very much liked what you said, but on the other hand, you want to put in practice, I don't know, something which is very vague. All the notions, all the categories which we are using here, and try to measure them. I'm not a psychologist, that's why I'm very skeptical about these schemata and drawings. But how can you measure care, right? These concepts are vague concepts, and it's good that they are vague because they offer up a certain sphere of negotiation, right? Mm-hmm. And they open up a sphere of a kind of, I don't know, Levinas would say, of an encounter, right? As long as you can encounter something that you know what you are encountering, or you are encountering someone from the position of knowing yourself fully, of, I would say, yeah, this is Jean-Luc Nancy, but this sovereign identity, then communication is impossible, right? And what you are, I don't know, perhaps this is the effect of pragmatic tradition, right? I don't know. I find this a utopian practice, not a utopian theory. I mean, the third part of your lecture, go and talk, right? Go and meet people, right? This can be done, but provided that Marx would say, superstructure, your own identity is already somehow softened. And that's why I think there's a lot of work to be done in terms of changing identity of, I don't know, of redefining, I know, politics of friendship, right? All the things which some postmodern theory is doing, and perhaps without measuring it. And I think that Lennon was a part of that kind of dreamy gun, perhaps coming back generation. So these are the comments and actually questions too.
Okay, very good. Okay, so first, as for how we measure it, yes, these terms are quite abstract, as virtues always are. But part of doing the science of this is you operationalize it in many different ways. And if you get the same results in many operationalizations, then you can be confident. So we've done it with a variety of different kinds of questionnaires. We get this result. We've done it by asking people to make ratings of different groups. What do you think of nurses, nursery school teachers, hunters, soldiers? So people whose occupations are linked to these foundations, we get the same effect in those ratings. We've looked at sermons given in liberal and conservative Protestant churches. And we count the words related to those foundations. We get the same effects. So these are the kinds of things people talk about. Now, conservatives love their children. They are nice to their dogs. I'm not saying conservatives are lower on compassion. But what I'm saying is when they think about the kind of society they want, what kind of laws do we want? They just don't talk about compassion. That's not what we're trying to build and regulate with our laws. They have other concerns. So everybody has access to these taste buds, these ideas, but they use them to different degrees when they're trying to build a society. Now, as for how you actually get people to talk, is it utopian? If I were to say everybody should simply go find a stranger on the other side and have a real heart-to-heart talk, okay, that's not very realistic. But you have one great advantage here, which is that your dominant religion is Catholicism. In America, the dominant religion is Protestantism, and Protestantism has 70 different denominations. And what's happened is the denominations are now splitting this way. So the Episcopalian denomination, a very important denomination, they're splitting in two, those who favor gay marriage and the ordination of women, and those who don't. So all of our religions are now basically purified on the right or the left. The one exception is Catholics. They're all stuck together. They can't split. So it's true that the Catholic Church is mostly on the right, but surely there are liberal Catholics. Surely there are Catholics who consider themselves Catholics, but feel more that they're on the left. The Catholic Church would be a great place to start this, because if you have overarching identities, if you have surrounding identities that you value, the conditions are then good. I'm sure, are there other civic institutions? Are there other places in Poland where you have people on the right and the left working together towards common goals? Just tell me some. There must be some. You have the Boy Scouts? I mean, what do you have here? It's what? They're split? Do you have a liberal Boy Scouts and a conservative Boy Scouts?
I'm not sure, but I know that there are
factions.
There are factions, really?
Okay.
You have city movements, okay. Okay, great. That's right, great. So the point of this is not centrism. I personally am sort of a centrist, but the idea is you don't need a centrist party, you don't need a centrist movement. What you need is, I would actually call it a sort of a national greatness movement. I say that that title actually deliberately appeals to the right more because it's harder to get the right to do this. In America, whenever you get groups working for bipartisan cooperation, it's almost all people on the left and then one guy who's a little bit right of center. So you need to appeal more to the right to do this. But you're doing it for the good of the country, ultimately. So if you can find any of these organizations and have a movement, not a centrist movement, but a, what do you want to call it, a vibrant democracy movement, something like that. I think there's a chance to do something like that. Any other questions? Yes.
I actually have two. One is about to what extent the factors or the only care, fairness, loyalty, the six factors you have listed, to what extent does the divide translate into different cultures? I have seen your TED talk where you flash the similar slides for different cultures, but my question is, to what extent are you convinced that this survey really gives you a true image? One example I have is, for example, China. I know leftist Chinese who are also very nationalistic. Mm-hmm. It's a small group, but it's it sort of contradicts. Perhaps it's this one fact that I find, and then I have questions. Yeah. And the second question is about the role of the political system, because both Poland and US, we have very strongly majoritarian systems. And in this system, majoritarian systems, so we have just two parties, and then nothing, mostly. Mm-hmm. And then in this system, it actually pays off to polarize, and it's very easy to build political capital in such a setup. So talking about systemic change, perhaps that's, what's your idea about pushing this forward?
Okay, very good. So on the first question, how does this translate across countries? It's very difficult to do direct comparisons across countries on the means because there are translation issues. First of all of our data comes from people who took the survey in English. So it's, our data is not representative of the country. But even still, in any country, people who identify themselves as being on the left fit the pattern that I showed here. I'm pretty sure I've looked at China. Certainly if you group together the East Asian countries, South Asian countries, Latin American countries, we find the same converging pattern everywhere. So that's the first thing. It's a very general thing about the left and right. In my book, I talk about the origins of the psychology. Political attitudes are highly heritable based on certain traits such as openness to experience and compassion and conscientiousness. So the left-right divide is not an historical anomaly. It's rooted in a universal psychology. Now, facts of history can really scramble things. And so obviously in Poland, you have this gigantic fact that you had this barbarity called communism imposed on you from outside. And it is obviously on the left. And your current left party is tainted by association. So I'm hearing over and over again that for people on the left, there really isn't representation, there really isn't a party. And that will probably be true for another 10 or 20 years. Eventually, you'll get far enough away from communism that you can have normal left and right parties like other European countries. But for now, you don't. China would be the same thing. It's not the traditional left-right issues of Europe. It's going to all be about communism. And they've only won. So eventually, that's right. So I think when you have a free society over many decades, the parties tend to settle into something like the left-right dimension, and eventually Poland will get there. For now, it's not like other European countries, but it is like many of the other post-communist societies. So what I'm saying is there is some psychology that's universal, but the particular facts of history can really push things around quite a lot so that each country is unique. On the question of governance models, so the biggest problem, so there's two issues. There's rising polarization, which is happening in the US and in many other countries. Not all. It's happening in a lot of countries. And then there's the question of whether that polarization is crippling. In the United States, our revolution was against tyranny of the king and the British government. And so our founders wanted a system in which it was very hard for the government to become tyrannical. So we separated the powers. We don't want a very strong executive. We want other branches and other divisions to be able to check the power. That made sense in 1788. It doesn't make as much sense now. And our system cannot function with polarization. Our system can only lead to legislation when one party controls the lower house, the upper house, and the presidency. And that's why nothing gets done anymore. We have gigantic problems, and we just let them sit there and get worse. We can't deal with them. And that's going to go on for a long time. So we're in big trouble. A parliamentary system can survive. Now, you have a parliamentary system, right? You don't just have, I mean, you're not limited to. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's right. So for now, so that's bad. And eventually you'll, I would bet that in 5 or 10 years, you'll have more than these two parties. Things will evolve. The parties do change. And a parliamentary system is much more flexible than our constitutional system. So you might look ahead to that. People on the left should probably be thinking, what will the next configuration look like? What is the story that we can tell on the left, let's say, that could lead to attracting a lot of people and that doesn't link the left to communism? So eventually it will change, and you have the flexibility in a parliamentary system to do that. The key is that your political system incentivizes leaders to go for the middle, not the extremes. And unfortunately, in the American system, our congressmen don't care about the election because they're going to win. Each district is just one party now, pretty much. All they care about is the primary election, the first election within the party. And so to win that, you have to be extreme, because only a few people vote in that. So it's a ridiculous democracy that we have right now. It's not working. Other questions? Other ideas for how to apply this to Poland? Of course, journalists have been asking me. And it's always so complicated, especially the Polish situation, that I try to be vague. I try to not give specific policy advice, because I just don't know. But do any of you have ideas for how you could use moral psychology or to improve things, or how you could reform the political system in Poland to make it more effective? Oh, yes?
I have a question.
OK, ask them.
Can use that, but not necessarily.
Hi. My question would be, since we know that strategic reasoning about moral decisions is slow, effortful, requires attentional resources, etc., and you showed a very nice timeline that showed the split between the parties, mm-hmm. that showed this outgroup derogation and group bias, would you happen to have any data that would show what happened with, for example, post-formal reasoning in the United States, according with the same timeline? I mean, do we have this drop in post-formal reasoning, which kind of goes through coalitional boundaries, right? That's the kind of definitional post-formal reasoning.
When you say post-formal, you mean like Jean Piaget?
Yeah, Kohlbergian.
Post-conventional,
exactly.
Reasoning.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I have no reason to think that Americans are getting stupider.
Less effort, maybe.
Less effort. Well, no, so this would be, actually that suggests a very good experiment. So my view is that Kohlberg was wrong to focus on reasoning. I don't think reasoning is that important. But what I would predict is that you can take very smart people who can do post-conventional reasoning, which is where you reflect not just on what is right, but on why, on what justifies it, on how you could have a whole system. So it's more complex, advanced reasoning. So it'd be great to show that you get people who can reason in a post-conventional way about certain things, and then you take the same problem, but you make it a political problem. You link it to abortion or gay rights or gender, and suddenly you would find, I think, that they get stupid, that they're not able to integrate information. That is
great idea, thanks.
So yeah, so please do that. Somebody here do that experiment. That would be a fun one to do. Show that people get stupid when, you know, in America there used to be these advertisements, this is your brain, and they'd show a frying pan, and then they drop an egg into it. This is your brain on drugs. Don't do drugs. So, you know, we all make fun of it, but it's a common joke now in America. So you could have a set of studies, this is your brain. This is your brain on politics. Don't do politics. Something like that. Yes?
My question is, do you have any data or some research from countries where society was divided not only by polarizing, but later started a war, for example, or some greater conflict? I ask in context of Ukraine, because I'm actually from Ukraine, and I just want to predict which possibilities, can be.
Yeah. So the best way to, there's what's called the rally around the flag effect, which is very well known, and you can figure it out just from the title. Human beings are very good at tribalism, but we're also very good at individualism. And nothing brings people together like a foreign attack. So after the 9/11 attacks in the United States, there was a surge of patriotism. People supported, even George Bush was not that popular before the attack, but suddenly he was very popular. People get more conservative, they get more religious. They get more focused on these groupish sorts of virtues. So a foreign attack is very good for that. Obviously, Ukraine has been attacked by Russia. And of course, some of the Russians in the East are in favor of it, but for the Ukraine, I don't know anything about Ukraine other than what I read in the newspaper, but I would imagine there's been more support for the government and more patriotism among most of the country. Is that true? Okay, so that's very predictable. The other thing that we can say, there's actually a publication by Joe Henrich, a leading cultural psychologist, Joe Henrich, H-E-N-R-I-C-H. He and a team of researchers, they did behavioral economics games in Georgia, the country of Georgia, and Sierra Leone. And what they found is that, you know, these are games where you're playing a game, you can contribute something or not, you can be a free rider or not. And what they found is that people who were between, I think they found it was between like 12 and 20 or something like that. There was a window in which people who were in that age, they're teenagers, during the war, those people, even 10, 15 years later, those people are much more cooperative. And so that's one of the studies I was referring to before when I talked about the greatest generation, those shaped by World War II. So again, events in your teen years, just, you know, 10-year-olds don't understand, they don't think about politics. But 14, 15-year-olds, they're beginning to think about those things. So in those early years of your political life, a foreign attack can have permanent effects. Unfortunately, things like global warming are not like a foreign attack. They don't activate. Those are drawn out threats that are not, they're not a person. They're not. So there are many other threats that don't activate this coming together reflex, but a foreign attack by an enemy does. Okay, time for one last question and then we'll stop. Or we can just stop and I'll hang out. If you have another question, please come up and see me. Thanks very much.